Welcome, friends, to this afternoon session of our first day of this three-day event here in Newport Beach. Happy to see you all again. I want to apologize for coming late to the afternoon session. I was also about 5 or 6 minutes late in the morning session. Both these were arranged late comings. The morning late coming was arranged because I was told on the telephone, this chair of mine is not here. I don't know where it was coming from, but it wasn't here. So they told me, come very slow. So we had to slow down so that allow for the chair to come. Now we had to arrange a delay because we were told that the food arrived late. That if I come in time, people will still be having their lunch. So these are arranged late comings. I still apologize because normally I don't go even by arranged late comings. But when I do get late, I tell a story. I can still tell you the story. It's a true story. The big companies, big retail stores, like Macy's and other big stores, they have recently been hiring retired people as greeters to greet customers at their gates, at their doors. And that has led to increase in sales, and because these customers are all old retired people, they're very kind and speak very nicely. In one Walmart store, they recruited a retired guy, and he was very sweet to people, and people loved him. But he would every day come 15 minutes late. The manager of the store said, you are such a nice person, you talk so nicely, everybody loves you, but you come late every day. What would the people say in your office where you worked earlier if you came late like this? So the man put his head down. He said, they would say, good morning, Admiral, shall we bring you a coffee now? So I use the Admiral story. That as I said in the morning, I'll take up some questions if you have written out any questions. Do we have any questions? George, you have any questions?
Yes, I have a lot.
Okay. I'll take up a few questions now.
Would a Radhaswami initiate used to focusing at the front of the forehead benefit from focusing in the pineal area if they can? I'm finding that difficult.
I read the question again. Would a Radhaswami initiate used to focusing at front of forehead benefit from focusing in pineal area if they can? I am finding that difficult. I was also brought up by a master on the spiritual path, whose picture you see here. Great master, Hazur Maharaj Baba Sawan Singh. He was also following this Radhaswami tradition. And we used to use greeting. Radhaswami was the greeting we used to greet each other as fellow satsangis, fellow followers of the same master. And what I am sharing with you are his teachings. The Radhaswami teachings are no different from what I have been sharing with you. When they mention the forehead, they are not suggesting that the attention should be on the forehead. They are only locating the place behind which you have to go. When you put your attention behind the eyes at the third eye center, which is close to the pineal gland or the pituitary body, then you put your attention behind there and you feel you are standing up there, it's right behind the forehead right here. So this is just a manner of locating where you have to go in the forehead, not in the heart center, not in the other lower centers. It's just a way of indicating. If you only put your attention on the forehead, then you will not be able to pull your attention toward yourself at all. So that is why it's a misunderstanding that the attention has to be kept in front at the forehead. It's at the area of the forehead, but behind the eyes at the third eye center.
With eyes open, the self is already operating from the third eye center. Can we now just close the eyes and hold this position at the third eye center for meditation instead of trying for imagination?
Is it a question or an answer?
I think it has both parts.
Okay. With eyes opened, the self is already operating from third eye center. Can we now just close the eyes and hold this position at third eye center for meditation instead of trying for imagination? If you can hold your attention where you are, nothing else is needed. Meditation can be done with eyes open or with eyes closed. Why we close eyes is because what we see outside distracts our attention. It's not a question of finding a place or imagining where the third eye center is. We are there with eyes open. Eyes open take our attention outside. The game is of attention. We have to put attention on our own self. If your eyes are open, ears are open, there are distractions outside, it becomes more difficult. If your eyes are closed, ears are closed, you are in a dark, quiet place, light does not bother you, it's easier to put your attention on third eye center. So it does not mean that you have to do anything to be there. You are there. But by keeping the eyes open, your attention is automatically scattered. It is already scattered so much. How the attention operates from that very center, first it spreads out in the body. And we become aware, I have a body, I have a trunk, I have got arms and hands and feet. It's all scattering of attention. Then from the body, it scatters outside with the attachments and desires we have for this physical world. Constantly we are remembering them. Our attention flows, whatever we remember. It's a very scattered attention. When we try to put our attention on our own self, this scattered attention distracts us. So that is why it takes time to put your attention back on yourself. But if you have got your eyes open, you're seeing things outside, attention goes what you are looking at. That is why in the beginning, it is necessary to avoid distractions that are preventing you from concentrating your attention on yourself. After some time, you can do. I remember one friend of mine who's sitting right in this audience right now, happened to be here. He accompanied me to India and met one of the ladies who was very close to Great Master and served Great Master for 40 years. Her name was Bibi Lajo. And this friend of mine, who is present here today, I'm very happy, he asked her, can you also do open-eyed meditation? She said, yes, I'm used to it. So she, with her open eyes, she meditated. We could see that she was not here, that she had pulled herself inside. And the eyes were not necessarily closed. So this friend of mine had a nice video camera. He said, this is a good time to take a video camera of open eyes that I can carry to America. Everybody can meditate with eyes open. He took there some pictures. When we played, it was all blank. Nothing came on there. So it is not a question of closing eyes for the sake of meditation. It is closing eyes to prevent a distraction from concentrating our attention on ourselves.
Master, could you explain the structure and characteristics of the body in the third eye center, astral level and causal level?
Could you explain the structure and characteristics of the body in third eye center, astral level, and causal level? I can.
Okay.
It'll be a new lecture, of course. Very briefly, I'll still take up this question briefly. The physical body looks like what it is to our appearances based on the physical matter it contains. The appearance of the physical body is made up of physical matter, and we see physical matter when we look at a physical body. We can see the ears, eyes of a person, hands, feet, the whole body we can see is all made of matter, physical matter, consisting of atoms. When we go to the third eye center and we feel we have a body which can see, which can touch, taste, smell, it has no matter. It's made up of perceptions, sense perceptions. Astral body is nothing but the capability of ourself to sit with the soul, mind, and sense perceptions without matter. That makes the astral body. So what happens when we see the astral body? One of the big characteristics is it has no matter, yet it is in the same place, the perceptions are in the same place on that body as on the physical body. So the feeling is we have everything, including a skin, everything. That's just a perception that we can see the body exactly like this. But it's so light because there's no matter. If you jump up, you can fly as much as you like. So easy to fly in the astral body, there's no matter in it. The brain of the astral body is not matter, and therefore it functions somewhat differently. The difference in the astral brain and physical brain is the physical brain is very dense and we don't use it fully. For example, for the sake of communication between people, this physical brain and the physical mind needs to have words, spoken or written language, which can be understood by both parties. That is how we communicate. I'm speaking in English, most of you speak English, you understand what I'm saying. If I suddenly started speaking in my own language, many of you won't understand. So this handicap of having to use a particular language to communicate exists because of the dense nature of the physical brain. The astral brain has no problem communicating with astral ideas, which transfer without physical spoken language or written language. What we call telepathic communication. Some people say we can communicate telepathically here. When they say that, they are actually using the astral brain and the astral power. But they might not have noticed that when they communicate an idea telepathically, even in the physical plane, they are not using language. They are using what they want to say, and the other person understands what they are saying. Supposing you have a friend living in Germany who doesn't know English and you don't know German. In a telepathic communication, you can think of something in English, the person in Germany will understand it in German. This automatic, like an auto-translation of spoken and written languages. So that is why communication in the astral body is very different. Furthermore, the astral brain can see through the working because of the same factor that the ideas can travel through like that telepathically. It's normal. It's normal there. In that state, it's normal to communicate like that. Therefore, we can normally have the ideas known of each other very quickly. And therefore, there are not too many secrets there. And like we keep secrets here, there you can read the secrets. Therefore, they are no longer secrets. Or they are like the secret I was sharing with you. I was saying, keep my secret and don't tell anyone. I told a crowd in Davis the other day. This is a secret, don't tell anyone. And if you tell, please tell them not to tell anyone else. So that kind of secret. In this state where we are now, secrets can be used for many reasons. For example, if I want to tell a story to all of you, I'll tell the first person here, don't tell anyone, it's a secret. By evening, everybody will know. That's how secrets are kept here. There, there are no secrets, so the whole intercommunication between people or souls in astral bodies is very different. Astral world is much bigger than this world. When you look at this entire universe, this entire universe looks infinite. It's not infinite. In a few years, maybe next 10 years or so, or maybe even earlier, you'll find the limits of this universe. And it'll be a very big shock to scientists. I'm sharing this with you today. Like I shared many scientific secrets long ago, they are saying you are right, now you are right. They were not right at that time. And the problem has arisen because we say this universe, this science is saying, not we. We, the scientists in this universe, have accepted that this universe came from a big bang, from a singularity. That means there was no world, no time, no space, and suddenly big bang took place, and space and time emerged, and with that emerged energy, and energy began to convert itself through a power called gravity into matter. And the first time gravity turned energy was the energy of one single electron that began to rotate in an orbit, creating a material gas called hydrogen. Next came, very quickly, within milliseconds, the next item, helium, and then it slowed down. And as the periodic table went on creating more matter in this universe, we have reached a stage where it takes a long time for a new matter to come up. This is an explanation given by science. They say it's an expanding universe. From that point, it expanded. I read the news today that they've just studied that the rate of expansion of this universe has been accelerating. It was slow earlier, it's faster. How did they find out? The only way they can judge the speed of expansion is from the movement of galaxies, which we have got good telescopes now. Every time we see the galaxies, they are moving away from us. Whether they are in the north, south, this side or that side, all are moving away. It caused a big puzzle at one time. Is Earth the center of this universe? If everything is moving away from here, then are we the center? One little planet of one solar system is the center of the universe? No, they tried every spot, anywhere you can go, is the center of the universe. So the center expanded into everything. So therefore, you can't find a center anymore. But from all sides, it's an expanding universe. Now problem has come, and will be coming in the next few years, that when you expand at a certain rate, you become bigger. This means before you expanded, you were smaller. At some point, it's just a point from where you begin to expand. Now we have telescopes that can go far and look into several light years. When you go one light year away from now, we are looking at what happened 1 year ago, not what is happening now. It's impossible to see anything what is happening now. We don't know anything. The further we go down into space, the more we are going to the past. So when they say we have reached 3 billion light years, that means they've gone into the past, what was existing 3 billion years ago. And they study it like that, as if it was the state of being 3 billion years ago. Now they've achieved 16.5 billion light years away and take pictures. Soon we'll reach 13.5 billion light years away, which is the calculated point. If we go backwards in this expansion, that's when the expansion started. That's a big bang. If it is truly a big bang, after 13.5 billion light years away, telescopes should see a single point from where the expansion started. It's going to show a much bigger world than ever existed. So there'll be a big conundrum at that time. And they'll have to find what they call new physics to explain what is happening. Some physicists are already hinting that we will find there is not one universe, several universes. We're just one of them. And therefore, we are now locating many other universes. And they have been able to go back to a concept that the singularity from which this expansion started was a black hole. A black hole can absorb everything, including light, including, now they say, time and space. If a black hole can catch everything and absorb it in zero space and zero time, and expand everything and create space and time, maybe we are just the product of the explosion from one black hole, and there are several black holes. We already found two in our own galaxy. We are finding many more outside. So that is why they are now trying to resolve this question of the Big Bang. But then the question will be, if the Big Bang took place from a black hole, the black hole is only created by absorption of matter and energy from outside. So there was a universe prior to that to create this universe. And there must be prior universes before that. So this will really throw away the current concept of a Big Bang. And this is going to come. So these problems, they don't notice. Fortunately, if you are meditating and are unaware of the physical body, but an astral body, you can travel backwards and forwards right to 13 billion light years now and see what the truth is. And the truth is very different from modern science accepts. But they will accept when they have better telescopes. So that's another big characteristic of the astral body and the astral self that can move fast into large areas. Now the characteristics, very briefly, the characteristic of the causal body, the mind. The mind that thinks today is our causal body. Thinking has created everything that we see here. It's a continuous machine. I was going to say, I'll talk to you tomorrow about how destinies are made, and I'll tell you a little more about destinies are made at that level, at the causal level. That's why it's called causal level. Everything is caused from there. The causal self has combined perceptions. It can perceive things without breaking them into seeing, touching, tasting, hearing separate. It does not need to break it like these physical and astral bodies have to break things into different sense perceptions to perceive. Causal body perceives in one go and does not require the separation of the senses. And this is something unique. Very difficult to understand here, but intellectually you can understand that there is something that all the senses can be combined and perceived at the same time. And that's characteristic of the causal body. Causal body or the mind can travel at the fastest speeds possible, much faster than any other thing can happen, much faster than speed of light, much faster than speed of the velocity at which the astral body can go. It's the fastest thing that can move in the created space and time that we know of. And that's a causal body. The causal body can also look at what looks at time and space created at once as one unit. When this creation takes place, several creations have taken place several times. When this particular creation takes place in which we are sitting here, the causal body can see the timeline and the space created in one go for different universes. And then it can see what events have been placed on those. I'll explain more detail tomorrow when I tell you how destinies are made, that the events that we are going through are placed in advance, in one go, at the causal plane. And all our experiences in time and space taking place in the astral and causal plane are set up on that line at that time. Wonderful experience to go and see that actually happening. These are a lot of big differences in experiences at the different levels. And imagine we sitting here have the capacity, the potential to see that within ourselves while we are still living here as human beings in a physical body. It's a miracle.
I have been wearing a yellow sapphire ring for a year now. I do not know if anything is different yet. Do you believe in the yellow sapphire? I am a Sagittarius after all.
Sorry. I'll read the question again. You can laugh again. I have been wearing a yellow sapphire ring for a year now. I don't know if anything is different yet. That should be good enough. You have answered your question right there. Do you believe in the yellow sapphire? Not after your answer. I am a Sagittarius after all, so am I.
Dear Ishwarji, please explain withdrawal of attention in detail. How I know if I am focusing attention or withdrawing attention? Yours.
Please explain withdrawal of attention in detail. How I know if I am focusing attention or withdrawing attention? It takes about 5 days to explain withdrawal of attention. We do it in a program called Intensive Meditation Retreat. And I have been holding these intensive meditation retreats where we meditate for 5 days or 6 days with a break for a day. And during that period, we go from the beginning to withdrawal of attention to where we can reach the top. And therefore, the process is not that simple because we've never done it. Withdrawal of attention simply means not putting your attention on anything and therefore withdrawing it to yourself. We are not used to that. We are continuously putting attention on something. It's a question of reversing our habit. Now, you can't reverse a habit overnight or in 2 days. So if we practice it over a period of time, we understand what withdrawal of attention is. Withdrawal of attention means that the attention returns back from where it's going out. Right now, everything we do in life, without exception, is putting attention on something. Everything. So we are so experts now in putting attention from the third eye center or other things, that is our normal way of looking at ourselves, looking at the world. And when we want to meditate, we still have the same tendency to look at something, put attention on something. Let me see what I can see. When you say, let me see what I can see, you are no longer withdrawing attention. If you can say, who is seeing what I am seeing? First step. Who is the one who is witnessing this? If I am the one witnessing, where am I witnessing from? Where am I? These are the kind of questions. And we have never tried to ask that kind of question in our life. That is why it becomes difficult. The difficulty is not doing it. Once you do it and are regularly doing it, it will become like a habit. Just like focusing attention is a habit, withdrawing attention will become a habit. Instantly you can withdraw once you practice. You'll be able to go anywhere at any level instantly once you practice it. But to practice it is different from just theoretical talk about it. I can only give you talk right now. But talk does not have much meaning if it is not followed by action. Another mistake we have. We go and learn things by talks, by books, by reading. We don't practice what we learn. We just read and feel happy we read it. We hear it talk, good. But we don't practice what we hear. So there's no real value. It's just a curiosity of the mind that we satisfy. But if you want to get results, then you must practice. Withdrawal of attention comes after a lot of practice. And it can start, if you start knowing, you use your awareness that you are alive, that you are a self, that you are awake, that you are you have imagination, you imagine yourself different places, you imagine you are doing different things, and who is imagining? Is yourself. By different activities you do with eyes closed inside, you begin to know who you are and not what you are seeing or what you are doing. So that is what brings the attention as a withdrawal of attention to yourself. There are many exercises that have to be done during these intensive meditation retreats. I do those exercises with my friends, and that is how we get actual results. That is why they become very popular, these intensive meditation retreats. And one reason why they are difficult to get in is because the number we have limited. If I want to do it for 500 people or 1,000 people, it's very difficult because each one has to be guided. Every participant has to be guided at different levels at which they have reached. And that should be possible. Group is small. So we have limited the group of people attending those meditation sessions to 65, 70 at the most. And that's a reasonable group. And we just had a series of these in the United States. People from other countries complained to me, why only USA is getting these IMRs? We should get, so we introduce IIMRs, International IMR. People are very fond of these initials, you know. So now we have, first time they told me, when is the next IMR? I didn't know what IMR was. I thought it's an MRI, some medical thing. Then they told me it's intensive meditation retreat, not MRI. And now it's IIMR. We opened up the next four IMR, one in the United States, and three overseas, one in Germany, one in Bali, and one in New Zealand. So it covers a lot of people from seekers from different parts of the globe. So when the IIMR was opened, we said you can attend only one to give chance to more people. But at least if people can attend one of them, four times people can come in the four of them. So they had to press a key on their computer at a fixed time which was announced in December. And on that day, people pressed the button and it said waiting list. They complained to me. We are the very first to press the button. How can it be a waiting list? So now it's a different entity running the computers who is doing this. And they said, we are arranging the registration according to the timing at which you press the button. Now, I found out that 400 people pressed the button at the same time. So only 60 at each place were taken. So how did it happen? I checked with the company that runs that program. And they said, we can show you the difference in milliseconds. Milliseconds. That 1 second could take up several of these. So actually, the whole thing was over in a few seconds. Except one place, New Zealand took a little longer. So I felt little sorry for those who had been waiting for a long time to get into this intensive meditation retreat, which I think is a very practical way of using what I share with you. Practical ways to apply it and work on it. So I felt sorry so many people tried to come in and couldn't come in. So I decided that we'll have some meetings outside of the IMRs, where people who have been waiting to come there can meet and I can have a short meditation session at least, so they can also get an experience. So that is I'm trying to satisfy myself. But on the other hand, as a businessman, I felt very happy. A lot of demand. So that is how they judge in business, for the product. A lot of demand, must be a good product. And I'm mentioning this thing because it is a question of attention. And to put attention, withdraw attention, requires something different from what we are using attention for all this time. So that is why it's a practice that is needed. I can share only this much to you, that if you are able to imagine that you are not in the body, which is not easy either, if you can imagine you are not in the body, but in your head, just like you can imagine you are standing there. I had a big problem, I'm telling you personally, when I was initiated. I could not imagine how to put my attention there. And then my master, great master, I went to him. I said, tell me, I can't go inside and stand there and do anything. You say, start your meditation at the third eye center, not outside. So he said, can you imagine where you, wherever you are? He said, raise your index finger right up in the air. So I raised it up. He said, can you imagine you're sitting there, not here? I used my imagination. Of course, I can go up, right? I can be there. Imagination can go anywhere. So I imagined I was there. He says, are you there? I said, yes, I am on top of my finger. He said, bring it down slowly. Are you still there? Yes, I'm still there. Bring it up in front of you. Are you still there? I am still here. Jump inside. I jumped inside. I was there. Just an exercise he did for me, just to show the imagination that you are there is as easy as imagining you somewhere else. Now, when you imagine you are there, you are not focusing on anything. You are there. Not that you are seeing somebody there. You are imagining you are there. So when you imagine you are there, then what can you do? You can stand up, sit down, dance, walk, do what you like. You don't see yourself doing these things. You do it in that imaginary form. So that is an easy way to bring your, to withdraw your attention to yourself. There are other ways also. But I'm just giving you a hint of how this can be done with practice, and then it becomes easy to withdraw attention.
How did God create himself? Who created him? Yazan El Hassanai, 8 years old.
How did God create himself? Who created him? Good question. Many people have asked me this. When I ask a Christian ask me this question, and I say the answer is given in the Bible. We have read it. I said, go and read again. Read John's Gospel. Read the opening sentences of John's Gospel in your Bible. What does it say? In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. What clearer definition do you want? Very clear. And the Word was God. Not in the beginning. He's not the creator of God. What's the creator? Word. Word created God. What kind of word can create God? The sentences that follow says nothing was created that was not created by that word. Not only God was created by word, everything you can ever experience was also created by the word. In Islam, you should read the definition of the kalma and the naad. In the Vedas, read the Rig Veda, describes the same thing, exactly almost a translation. You go to old scriptures, they give a definition. But a definition we have never been able to understand. How can a word create a creator? What kind of word is that? I said, I look up an American dictionary. They will tell me what kind of word it is. It's a word with capital W. So I looked up the dictionary, and it said, word means the Bible. Now, what an erroneous idea that a book, no matter how holy it is, can create God and create the whole universe. And why are these words being used in every religion? That something that was like a word or a sound, naad, bhange asmani, the Sufis have been telling us, the sound, music of the spheres. Why are they saying word which can be spoken and heard, a word that can be written, at that time in the beginning couldn't even be written, only spoken. A word that could be spoken in the beginning, a music that can be heard, something that is audible is being described as the creator of God. There's a reason for this. The reason is, if you want to ask my opinion, what is the substance of which God has made that can create everything? I look back scientifically and from my experience, what can create everything is unlimited totality of consciousness. If somebody said, what is the ultimate God in my definition, I'll say it's the ultimate totality of consciousness which can be conscious of anything it wants. Whatever it becomes conscious of becomes creation. Very simple, understandable. But I am not putting human consciousness into it, totality of consciousness, which is different. And I say that we can reach that and achieve that by expansion of consciousness to that total level. It's available to us. But when we say God, we are talking of that power of totality of consciousness acting to do more than being just merely conscious. It's now being conscious of a creation, becomes a creator. This process takes place in our true home, where we can reach by our own method of going within our own self. Anyone can go there. So when we go there, we discover that the consciousness became a creator with having a creation. No creation, no creator. Therefore, the creator or concept of God came only from a creation. There's a creation, therefore there's a creator. Many ways to explain it, but the simplest way to explain it is that consciousness wants to be conscious of something. Otherwise, it wouldn't be even called consciousness, it would be called something else. Why did they not call, in the Bible or in other scriptures, why did they not call it a power? A power is a very limited thing. Power is an application that you can see in different ways. Therefore, they had no word to really describe it. And for want of word, they are calling it word, sound, music. In the Sikh scriptures, they call it shabd. They say there, one of the quotes is, Shabde dharti, shabde akash, shabde shabd mein aprakash. Who created shabd? Shabd created shabd. Supposing we want to carry this forward, who created who? Okay, we were created by our inner self. Okay, who created inner self? God created inner self. Who created God? Word created God. Who created word? It can go on forever, this question. Who created what? Therefore, all of these scriptures say that one created itself. Not God created itself. The word created itself. It is itself a creative power. It's a creative power that can create all. It's a conscious power that creates anything that can be made aware of or conscious. So that is why the description is simple. Now, why should you say sound or word? When in the time, in the zero time, zero space, there is no sound and no word, how do you call it sound and word? There's good reason for that. The reason is that the self, which is just a manifestation of the same consciousness when made into a unit, that becomes the self. Totality is total, can be called ultimate God, and its unit becomes a soul or the self as we experience it. The self, many selves amongst one. So we as a self are part of God. It's just a part. Like I said, a drop of water is part of the glass of water, it's part of the ocean. Drop of water is not a drop, it's the ocean contracting to a drop, it can expand, becomes an ocean. That is the soul, our individual self. When it comes down further, it adds on a capacity to itself, which we call mind, and able to create what it's experiencing into time and space and becomes a very wide experience just by adding on something to it. Like I wear a jacket, I'm adding on something to me. The soul wears a mind and expands to have a different kind of experience. Then what happens? Then the very soul, the very self begins to emit some kind of a sound. When it comes to a physical body, the self is still there. And what the self is doing, it's experiencing creation. Is it experiencing itself also, or only creation? It's experiencing creation. If an experiencer is experiencing something, does it experience itself without any creation? This question is arising in the level of God, as well as arising here. You find that the self in the physical body is emanating something that resembles sound, which means you can hear yourself. Hear your ultimate self right here, the physical body. Because it is audible, therefore we have used these words even for God, for the Creator. It's the audible, sometimes we refer it to as audible life stream. The life itself has come from something that is audible here. And that is why word, sound, shabd, nad, all these words have been used. Bhangya, swani, kalma, all these are words expressing the existence of the creative power. This is the language of God, sometimes they say, the sound that we can hear. That is why there are so many types of yoga. I tried so many types myself, just to see which is the best. I did not want to just go by claims. This is the best. Everybody claimed to have the best. I said, if all are of the best, let me find bestest of the best. I found the bestest of the best as the yoga called Surth Shabd Yoga, which means attention placed on the sound leading to union with your true self. It's again putting attention on the sound. Now, when we meditate on the self, what is the easiest way to put your attention on the self, to hear the self? It is a sound. You don't have to find how to find the self. Self is emanating a sound. When can you hear it? When you have the least distraction from outside, when it's least scattered. So first, do anything. Many steps can be taken to avoid distractions from outside. When the distractions are minimum, you will hear the sound of your own self. And that's the sound that we really want to hear. When you hear that sound, you're automatically pulled to the self. You're withdrawing automatically by doing something like listening. Listening can withdraw yourself because there is a sound in the self itself. It's a sound only here. The sound changes and becomes non-sound beyond the mind. This is a long talk, but some occasion I'll explain more, maybe during my stay here, how the sound operates and how it creates different forms of experiences. So that is why we have said God is ultimately the audible sound, the word, the shabd.
It's 4:15.
Last question for today. I'll take up the rest tomorrow.
Master Ikir Paul said that in this cycle, the golden age would arise directly from the iron age, and the initiates would help bring it about. Could Ishwar speak to this new golden age?
Master Kripal said that in this cycle, the golden age would arise directly from the iron age, and the initiates would help bring it about. Could Ishwar speak to this new golden age? I live in my own golden age right now. I'm not waiting for it. I don't think anybody should wait for it. You can make your present life into golden age. Just expand your awareness. Expand yourself into the future. Bring the future here for yourself. You may not be able to bring a golden age in terms of a cycle of the creation, but you can make it golden age for yourself right now. If you are happy 24/7, you tell me, would you not call it a golden age? When you have no doubt in your mind and clarity, and you know the answers to your fundamental questions, not because you heard the answers, because you have seen the answers, and you are happy because of that, 24/7, isn't that a golden age? I live in the golden age. So I can tell you that the golden age can be brought here. So far as cycle is concerned, this is a evolution, like evolution took place of the species, evolution took place of the planet, evolution taking place of consciousness as applied here. A human being with our kind of brain, maybe slightly different, as we call it primitive brain, but it was still a human brain, was able to put up a few stones, pieces of stones, in front of him and separate one and say, there is one separate. And there was so much excitement, like a software engineer produces a new software in the Silicon Valley now. If you do that stone now, it has no value. What are you excited about? But the excitement was the same. Our awareness at that time was only limited to that. As time passes on in technology, in other work, in understanding philosophy, and so on, it expanded. It is expanding. Every 1,000 years, you will see a difference. Even the spiritual teaching that was taught 1,000 years ago are different from today's. These are more elaborate today than they were at that time. And even you go 2,000 years ago, it was still different. Evolution has taken place in everything. And that is why they say that there's an evolution by which things start very bright because population is little, people have a lot of free time, there are no distractions created, and therefore they are living in a golden age. Then they get into material inventions and things happen, other evolution takes place of technology and material goods and services, and there are more distractions. So the second age comes, Treta comes. After Kali Yuga, Iron Age, that's brought about. After, then Golden Age is when we destroy everything and go back to Kali Yuga again, Iron Age again. So this whole change is a cycle and has gone on over and over again. Lot of our experiences, you will notice if you go within, you notice, you can go back into time and future into time and see, it's all cyclical. The cycles are going on. The shortest cycle was described to me by an Indian mystic who said, it's only 3 points. In Punjabi language, he explained, Tapo Raj, Rajo Narak, Narakon Tap. Tapo Raj, Rajo Narak, Narakon Tap. Very simple. That we are doing meditation to improve our situation and therefore we become rich people. We get the rewards of our meditation, our tap. Our worship lead to good place, and good place we commit sins and go to hell. In hell we pray, we won't do it again, and we come and meditate again. Then we go back to two. So this is a 3-point cycle that's going on. Everything is going on in cycles like that, high and low. This is a big chunk of time on which the high and low takes place. In smaller chunks, it takes place even in our life. Good times come, bad times come. Good times come back. There is in geometry, a sine curve that goes up and down like this. There's an axis, which is normal, that sometimes is high, sometimes you're low, and you're high, low. In meditation, you have the same sine curve. Some days, meditation is very good. It was very nice. You felt very good. Second day, you can't even meditate. What happened today? Some bad thing. Then again, high. Similarly, they say there are biorhythms controlling our own intellect, emotions, and physical health. You go biorhythms, same way, up and down cycle. The whole concept of a rhythmic existence applies in every area. And therefore, this is different yuga, different epochs that have come, one after the other. Improving, 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 then destroying. Then again, starting from the beginning, improving, 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 destroying. It's been going on forever. Right now, they say we are in a bad state from where we'll destroy ourselves and then go into golden age. And the people say we can destroy very easily each other. Just one madman has to use a nuclear weapon of today's intensity, which will be from 1,000 to 10,000 times more powerful than the nuclear weapons used in the Second World War in Nagasaki, Hiroshima, and Japan. And each one can destroy a whole city, or maybe more than a city. Such weapons are in the possession of so many countries today. One will do that, second will respond, third will intervene, and we can very quickly destroy. Very few people are left. In fact, already people are asking me if there's a nuclear war, is there any safe place to stay, to avoid that? I said, yes, there are 3 or 4 places. They're very keen to know the names of those places. I'll put a market value on them. No, I'm not. I'm joking. All I'm saying is this destruction has to come at some point. The whole cycle has gone like this. So that destruction will come again. Now, when they say that Kirpal Singh said that initiates will participate in bringing the golden age after the destruction, they're saying that the initiates will survive. Maybe they'll have my list with them. Thank you very much.